Okay, so today's unit is computing research methods. The learners will develop an understanding of different computer-based research methods. They will plan their own research and carry out a research project based on an area of interest to them within a computer science. So you will be learning that how to do a research, right? You can hear, can you hear Abhidya?
Yeah, I can hear, sir.
Hello?
Yeah, I can hear you, sir.
Okay, that's fine. So the learning outcomes today we will discuss is number one, understand the computer-based research techniques. And number two is be able to plan a computer-based research project on a topic within the computer science. So let me start with the first learning outcome. And after the break, in the next session, we will start the second learning outcome. So let us see what is the research. The research is the systematic investigation into and study of materials and sources in order to establish facts and reach a new conclusion. So whenever you are systematically investigating, studying any material or source of information so that you should be able to establish any fact or identify any fact or prove any fact and come to some conclusion that what is the fact about is basically a kind of one definition of the research. Normally, there is no any agreed upon definition of the research, but there are many things that describe the research. Like the systematic, rigorous investigation of a situation or a problem in order to generate a new knowledge or validate existing knowledge. So there are many more definitions as well. So the main purpose is to investigate a systematic investigation of a study of a material in order to understand its facts as well as to come up with new ideas. Now, there are lots of types of techniques for research, and obviously you will only be dealing with only particular one or two methods. However, you should be able to understand as a student of a particular the course that which is about the computing research, so that you should be able to select an appropriate methodology. So as a course, there are certain types of research such as desk research, ethnography, focus groups, interviews, online communities, mobile research surveys. So let us have a look on certain types of research techniques, and we will superficially go through those and we'll come to our main topic. So applied research, it refers to the scientific study and research that seeks to solve practical problems. Applied research is used to find solutions to everyday problems, cure illness, and develop innovative technologies rather than to acquire a knowledge for knowledge sake. For example, improve agriculture's crop production, treat or cure a specific disease, improve the energy efficiency of homes, offices, or modes of transportation. So simply, the research could be done without giving any benefit or solution to any particular area or subject, while whenever you are directly dealing with and applying your research in order to improve something, to handle something, is basically called the applied research. So whenever, for example, if you have a theory and you want to apply the theory into a particular kind of practical field, it becomes basically the applied research. For example, if you have a computer science research based on certain theoretical concepts, and based on those theoretical concepts, you want to apply, such as, for example, in medical science. So in medical science, your computational power could be applied in order to interpret any medical phenomena. It is also a kind of applied research. You can apply the research into any agricultural field. You can apply the research into any mechanical field. So whatsoever, when it comes to the theoretical research, it is the basic research, while when it comes to the applied research, then you apply research in order to give some get some solutions, and in order to study some behavior of a physical science. Basic research. The basic research is driven by scientists' curiosity or interest in a scientific question. The main motivation is to expand man's knowledge, not to create or invent something. There is no obvious commercial value to the discoveries that result from the basic research. So as I explained earlier, that the applied research is basically performed in order to give a solution. However, basic research is just for the knowledge. For example, how did the universe begin? What are protons, neutrons, and electrons composed of? How do slime molds reproduce? What is the specific genetic code of the fruit fly? So simply, basic research, it has less intention to do anything to a particular physical entity, or maybe it can be related with anything, but does not intend to improve or give any solution. However, just for the knowledge purpose, the research is done. So it's about the basic research. The next is correlational research. The correlational research refers to the systematic investigation or statistical study of the relationships among two or more variables without necessarily determining causes and effects. So correlational is the research in order to determine the relationship between the two things. It seeks to establish a relation, association, or correlation between two or more variables that do not really lend themselves to experimental manipulation. For example, to test the hypothesis, for example, listening to music lowers blood pressure levels. There are two ways of conducting research. So the hypothesis is that when you listen to the music, it lowers the blood pressure. Now, how you can do? You can do by experiment, or you can do by survey. If you want to do the experiment, then group samples and make one group listen to the music and then compare the BP levels. So you can check it whether it really helps, and it really works in the way that whenever the people listen to the music, and you want to know that really if the music is lowering their BP level or not. However, the other way is survey. Ask people how they feel, how often they listen, and then compare that whether what they say and does the majority of people really believes that whenever they listen to the music, and are they really comfortable, and do they lower the blood pressure. So it's a kind of correlational research that really interprets the relationship between the two entities. Correlation has advantages and disadvantages. Correlation advantages can collect much information from many subjects at one time, can study a wide range of variables and their interrelations. Some disadvantages: correlation does not indicate causes and effects, problems with self-report methods. So the correlation in simple is the relationship between two things. You do A and then you expect B. If you do C, then you expect C. So it's a kind of relationship research. Next is descriptive research. Refers to the research that provides an accurate portrayal of the characteristics of a particular individual, situation or group. Descriptive research, also known as statistical research. These studies are means of discovering new meaning, describing what exists, determining the frequency with which something occurs, and categorizing information. The descriptive research, in short, deals with everything that can be counted and studied. The descriptive research is related with any countable and being studied, which has an impact of lives of people it deals with. For example, finding the most frequent disease that affects the children of a town. So this study, for example, is dealing with a count, and it is a survey, a kind of information about the study, which is dealing with people. So which disease is basically affecting the people in the town? The readers of the research will know what to do to prevent that disease. Thus, more people will live a healthy life. So in the descriptive research, you are concerned about the counting and any particular study and its effect on people. So that's the descriptive study. Advantages: the people individual studies are unaware, so they act naturally or as they usually do in everyday situation. So any research comes in front of you in the form of descriptive research, it becomes a usual, and that looks like a normal situation. It is less expensive and time consuming than quantitative experiments, collects a large amount of notes from detailed studying, as it is used to describe and not make any conclusion, it is to start the research with. Like, for example, any study came in front of you in a newspaper, it gave you an information about the quantity, about the study, and about the people. For example, at many doctor surgeries, you knew that antibiotics don't help the viruses. So do not take any antibiotic if you have any flu or related symptoms. So obviously, a kind of descriptive study, the descriptive research can have some kind of relationship, the type of this research, so that people are just giving the information. Its disadvantages are that descriptive research requires more skills. Obviously, when you say something, then you are based on certain authentic knowledge. Does not identify causes behind a phenomena. And obviously, whenever you are throwing any information, then it is not necessary that you know that why it happens, and you are not supposed to do any research on it, that why it is happening, why the antibiotics are not effective in the viral infections. However, you simply define that what is likely to happen about that particular topic in a descriptive way. Response rate is low in this research. Obviously, this research is based on a highly skilled kind of sources, and when it is done, then it is in the form of descriptive only. It gives the information about the counting and its study, but actual experiment is not done very easily, and the results of this research can change over the period of time. So anything which comes in front of you, most likely in the media, that you observe is a kind of descriptive research, but it doesn't give you more details. Ethnographic research refers to the investigation of a culture through an in-depth study of the members of the culture. It involves the systematic collection, description, and analysis of data for developments of theories of cultural behavior. So whenever you are dealing with any cultural studies, it is basically the ethnographic study. So it studies the people, ethnographic groups, other ethnic formation, their genes, composition, resettlement, social welfare characteristics, as well as their material and spiritual cultures. So everything related with cultural things is the ethnographic research. Obviously, there are a lot of things to be researched into a particular culture, and there can be a lots of conclusions based on this research. Experimental research is an objective, systematic, controlled investigation for the purpose of predicting and controlling phenomena and examining the probability and the causality among selected variables. So, as an experimental research is objective, you have certain objective that why you are doing that particular research. Systematically and controlled investigation, you have to remain into a particular boundary of the research for a particular purpose. So its advantages are that best establishes the causes and effects relationships. However, the disadvantages can be artificiality, obviously, because within an experiment you are only limited and bound in a particular item or sample item on which you are doing the research, and it could be the artificial. And feasibility wise, it cannot be feasible to provide everything within that particular limited boundary of the research, and possibly it could be unethical when it is the experimental research. Sometimes the ethics are involved into a research, that whether are you allowed to do any research. For example, if you are dealing with any experiments with the animals, then any experiments, experimental results may be passed throughout certain ethical levels, and you should be very much aware before starting the research. You should know that is it okay, and does it comes under the ethics to go ahead with particular ethical particular research which ethics allow you. So we will be discussing the ethical issues in next slides as well. So experimental research continues. The simplest experimental design includes two variables and two groups of participants, and independent versus dependent. So the details may be skipped at this stage now, because we are generally discussing the types of the research superficially. We come to the next type of the research, which is the exploratory research, which is a type of research conducted for a problem that has not been clearly defined. Exploratory research helps determine the best research design, data collection method, and selection of subject. So exploratory research can be quite informal, because you want to explore something which relies on a secondary research. So possibly when you want to explore something, then it is not necessary that you explore everything by yourself, but you can rely on a secondary research. It means if somebody has already done a research on a particular topic, then you can rely on their research. So anything, whenever you are referring any research which has already been done, then it is basically the secondary research, such as reviewing available all literature or data, or qualitative approaches such as informal discussions with consumers, employees, management, or competitors, or more formal approaches through in-depth interviews, focus groups, product methods, case studies, or plot studies, pilot studies. So Exploratory research is basically the research of a phenomena where you want to explore, and obviously the things which has to be, the things which have to be explored can be further explored from the existing research, and then you can comment on. So this is a kind of research which is known as the exploratory research. Ground theory research is a research approach designed to discover what problems existing in a given social environment and how persons involved handle them. It involves formulation, testing, reformulation of propositions until a theory is developed. Ground theory is a research method that operates almost in a reverse fashion from traditional research, and at first may appear to be in a contradiction to the scientific method. So, ground theory in simple is an approach in order to solve the problems in a social environment and how persons involved handle them. It involves formulation, testing, and reformulation of propositions. Now, ground theory research. Basically, whenever if you want to explain certain problems and its solutions into the environment regarding, for example, if there is a problem in a community of the drainage system, while it is raining, then possibly the problem is how the drainages are affected due to heavy rain, and how people handle them, and how, which, through which formulation they are successful in draining their excess rain, and whatever the positions are involved there, and possibly those, their techniques, methodologies could not be, for example, an approved methods of the research. They could be in any reverse fashion, but however, the ground theory research basically studies those problems and their solutions. Historical research is a research involving analysis of events that occurred in the remote or recent past. So, applications of the historical research can show patterns that occurred in the past over the time, which can help us to see where we came from and what kind of solutions we have used in the past. Understanding this can add perspective on how we examine current events and educational practices. The steps involved in to conduct the historical research are identification of the research topic, data collection, evaluation of material, data synthesis, and report preparation. So obviously, historical research, as the name implies, is basically in order to research something based on existing patterns that occurred in the past to come up a conclusion that what was the past and why it happened and what was actually that particular thing. Historical research gives a social scientist a better context of making realistic decisions. It could be based on anything. Any research which is based on the past provides a comprehensive pictures of historical trends, uses existing information, provides evidence of ongoing trends and problems. So historical research is depending on the past. While it has the limitations, like it is time consuming and resources may be hard to locate, resources may be conflicting, may not identify the cause of the problem. Information may be incomplete, obsolete, inconclusive, or inaccurate. Data restricted to what already exists. So the historical research is depending on the findings of the past, but it has the advantages as well as disadvantages discussed like time consuming, resources may be obsolete, and blah blah blah. Phenomenological research is an inductive descriptive research approach developed from phenomenological philosophy. Its aim is to describe an experience as it actually lived by the person. Phenomenology is concerned with the study of experience from the perspective of individual, bracketing, taking for granted assumptions and usual ways of perceiving. They are based in a paradigm of personal knowledge and subjectivity and emphasizes the importance of personal perspective interpretation. So the phenomena that how a particular person thinks, perceives, behaves in order to study a particular phenomena related something regarding any people, an individual to be studied is basically the phenomenological research. So whenever you want to study an understanding of a particular phenomena related with a particular any particular individual or individuals, then you do basically the phenomenological research. On broader perspective, all researches can be classified into two groups. So far as we have discussed all these types of research techniques, starting from the, let's say, basic research to the experimental research, exploratory research, these kind of all researches like applied research, correlation research, all these researches are basically categorized into two ways. Number one is the qualitative and other is the quantitative. So quantitative or qualitative, let us see how the quantitative and qualitative is explained. In the qualitative research is a research dealing with phenomena that are difficult or impossible to quantify mathematically, such as beliefs, meanings, attributes and symbols. When it comes to know any idea, any phenomena which doesn't have a mathematical quantity or belief or meaning, attributes, such as any belief into the particular religion, any thinking, and when you want to identify that how people think about something, any idea, then it becomes a qualitative research. However, whenever you are dealing with a quantity, quantifiable numbers, then you are dealing with the quantitative research. The qualitative research aims to gather an in-depth understanding of human behavior and the reasons that govern such behavior. The in-depth understanding of human behavior and the reasons that govern such behavior, the qualitative method investigates the why and how of decision making, not just what, where and why, but why and how. So it is, when you say that why, then it doesn't give you a quantity that how, but it gives you a qualitative idea that why, the reason is qualitative. When you say that how many, it says it that is a quantitative. So overall, either you will be dealing with a qualitative or quantitative. The most of the social sciences or applied researches could be the qualitative. However, the computing research or the research which is dealing with numbers and scientific representation or scientific calculation is basically comes under the quantitative research. Advantages of the qualitative: it enables more complex aspects of a person's experience to be studied. Fewer restrictions or assumptions are placed on the data to be collected. Not everything can be quantified or quantified easily. Individuals can be studied in more depth. Good for exploratory research and hypothesis generation. The participants are able to provide data in their own words and in their own way. While disadvantages, it is more difficult to determine the validity and reliability of linguistic data. Now, the disadvantage of the qualitative is that validity and reliability of the linguistic data, means the language or the phenomena they are talking about, it is very difficult to validate. Whatever they are saying, it comes under their qualitative idea, qualitative interpretations. However, their reliability is difficult to prove. There is more subjectivity involved in analyzing the data. So, a data, if you want to analyze the data, why the data is that particular in direction, then you need a more subjective information. Data overload, open-ended questions can sometimes create lots of data which can take a long time to analyze. So if you are talking about a qualitative research and if you wanted to know a particular belief through a survey, through open questions, through closed questions, that why people think about particular phenomena, for example, why people watch TV, then you can say that there could be two answers, like the people watch the TV because they want to get the knowledge, one option, and second is that they want to be entertained in their spare time. However, if they could be given the third option to be explained, then they could answer anything else apart from these two options. Probably they could say that they watch the TV not for the entertainment, not for the in their spare time. Probably they could have any other reason of watching the TV. So the data could be overloaded when open questions, they are given an opportunity to answer on their own. So if they would answer on their own, then the research could be the conclusions of their open-ended questions can be difficult to be interpreted within the qualitative research. And obviously that will be the time consuming. So the qualitative research dealing with the ideas and beliefs which cannot be quantified. Now we come to the quantitative research. It refers to the systematic empirical investigation of any phenomena via statistical, mathematical or computational techniques. The objective of quantitative research is to develop and employ mathematical models, theories and hypotheses pertaining to a phenomena. So whenever it is these empirical investigation of a phenomena using mathematical or computational techniques, using statistical knowledge. Statistical knowledge is basically the knowledge which is coming through the certain statistics, like any repetitive relationship between the data through certain statistics. So it is the quantitative research. The quantitative research is generally made using scientific methods, which can be the generation of a model, theory, or hypothesis. You will be performing the research using certain model, theory, or hypothesis. the development of instruments and the methods of the measurement. You will be doing the research under certain methods and measurements, experimental control and manipulation of the variables will be involved, that how you will be how your experimental will be controlled and using which variables your research will be controlled into a particular domain of research, the boundary of the research. It gives you a collection of empirical data. The empirical data is basically the data which is given to you through certain processes and through certain order of the data by going through certain series of the data. You have some empirical and statistical data when you are dealing with the quantitative modeling and analysis of the data will be available, because you will have lots of data in a quantifiable amount, and evaluation of the results will also be included, that whether the results are being evaluated, are easy to evaluate or not. Hence, the quantitative research involves the evaluation. You can easily evaluate, you can assess the results, whether the outcomes are evaluation or evaluatable or not, or accessible or not. So the research, the quantitative research is basically the research dealing with a computer science. Most of the time, if you are doing the pure computer science research, however, if you want to include the both of the research types, like a quantitative as well as the quantitative research, you can do into your project as well. Now, the advantages and disadvantages of the quantitative research. Like the quantitative research allows the researchers to measure and analyze the data. However, in the qualitative research, you cannot measure the beliefs. You can only know that why and how. However, how many times these terms are not involved in the quantitative, the qualitative. However, in the quantitative research, allows you to measure and analyze the data. The researcher is more objective about findings of the research, because if you have to do a quantitative research, if you are expecting like an experiment based on samples of 100 items, then you can more be focused that and on time to know that, for example, how many items you have researched, for example 50, then you would know that 50 are left in order to complete your findings of the research. The quantitative research can be used to test a hypothesis in experiments because of its ability to measure the data using statistics. For example, if you say that painkillers or the paracetamols, they reduce about 50% of the type of the headaches in 1 hour. So if you do any test on 100 people, and if you give a paracetamol to 100 people, and if you knew that out of 100, about 50 to 60 people got a relief, then you are basically dealing with a quantity, and they would know that yes, this theory is 100% correct, that 50% people get a relief within 1 hour. So you are dealing with a kind of a quantitative conclusions. The disadvantages, the main disadvantage of quantitative research is the context of the study or experiment is ignored. So a context of the study is basically not considered. Only you extract the elements which give you a quantifiable parts of the study, and you drive those amounts or numbers from that particular study, and you ignore the particular study, what the study is about, but you only focus on the numbers. The quantitative research does not study things in a natural setting or discuss the meaning meaning things have for different people. So you are not concerned about the meaning of the things in the quantitative research. A large sample of the population must be studied for more accurate results. So quantity is most important. The more the quantity you have, you will have a more feelings and understandings. For example, if you did a quantitative research on two people and the result came out a 50-50, then you will not be sure and your research will not be accurate until you do a research on more than two, maybe more 50, 100 or thousands. So then and then you will be able to get accurate results if you have a sample size larger. Now, those were a kind of research techniques which we discussed in from the various sources of information and various types of researches applied in different domains. Few more to discuss, and then we will move to the sampling techniques, ethics, and data analysis techniques. So desk research, also known as secondary research, involves the summary, collation, and synthesis of existing research rather than primary research in which data are collected. For example, research subjects are experiments. In other words, gathering and analyzing information already available in print or published on internet. So desk research is basically the secondary research. You sit on the desk and search on the internet that what has already been done. Focus group is a form of qualitative research in which a group of people are asked about their perceptions, opinions, beliefs, and attitudes towards the problem, product, service concept. So advertising idea or packaging. So focus groups is a kind of also research which deals, you inquire from the focus from the group of people by interviewing, getting some information, researching people. I'm skipping this few more type of the researches: online research community, mobile search, survey. And now I'm going to discuss the sampling. The process of selecting a number of individuals for a study in such a way that individuals represent the larger groups from which they were selected. So when you are dealing with a number of individuals, basically, sampling is basically that on how many number of people you will be doing your research. So we discussed the type of or the techniques of the research. And now we want to know the techniques of the sampling. Sampling is basically that how many number of people or items you will be selecting in order to carry on a research. So probability based sampling, we discuss now. A probability sampling method is any method of sampling that utilizes some of form of random selection. If you are dealing with a random selection, then it is the probability sampling. In order to have a random selection method, you must set up some process or procedure that assures that the different units in your population have equal probabilities of being chosen. Humans have long practiced various forms of random selection. So in probability, you do not have any particular size of sampling, but you select on the random basis. Selective sampling techniques, the purpose of is basically the purposive sampling. When you say a selective sampling, it means you say a purposive sampling, also known as a judgmental sampling or selective or subjective sampling, the type of non-probability sampling technique. Non-probability sampling focuses on sampling techniques where the units that are investigated are based on the judgment of the researcher. So when you were selecting the sample size based on a probability, it was a random. But when you say a selective, then a researcher selects the number of samples based on the judgment of the researcher. Convenience sample, also known as availability sampling, is a scientific type of non-probability sampling method that relies on the data collection from a population members who are conveniently available to participate in the study. So it really depends. It is, the name implies, convenience based. For example, whichever the convenient number of people are available to you, then you select based on the convenience. Next is ethnographic methods. We discussed the ethnography. It was the study of the people, and you need to select the number of samples based on the available. Here we, the ethnography type of the research we discussed earlier. Let me show you. Ethnographic research, which investigated a particular culture. So the sampling size of an ethnographic research is discussed here, that how you will be selecting the ethnographic sample size is, let me explain. So ethnographic methods involved in the sampling techniques. There are four types of data collection using ethnographic research. One is the research type, and the other is the data collection. Participant and non-participant observation. If the participation and non-participation observation is involved, then watching or being part of social context, the semi-structured interviews, open and closed questions that cover the identified topics. The unstructured interviews could be the open questions that enable a free development of a conversation. Collected material, anything from artifact, text to letter or books or reports. So basically, whatever the type of the research within the ethnographic method is, you select the type of data collection accordingly. So the more you can study about the ethnographic research methods here, and you can know that how the ethnographic data collection can be done, and how the selection of the sample size would be more appropriate. We move further. The ethical standards. The research ethics is defined here to be the ethics of planning, conducting and reporting of the research, such as social responsibility, human rights, animal welfare, with laws and public health and safety. So when it comes to the, whenever you want to start the research, you will have to take care of the responsibility of the human rights, animal welfare, compliance with the law and public health and safety. So it is clear that the research ethics should include protections of human and elements, animals. Obviously, whatever the research you are carrying on, it should give a protection to human and animals. No human or animal should be harmed. However, not all researchers use human or animal subjects, nor the ethical dimensions of the research confined solely to protections for the research subject. So other challenges are rooted in many dimensions of the research, like the collection use or interpretations of the research data. Obviously, you will have lots of problems in organizing the and collecting the data. You will have lots of ethical issues, and you will have lots of problems while dealing with the research. Certain ethical principles are that you should be beneficent to do good, non-malfeasance to do any harm to anyone else, respect for autonomy. It should be fairness, truthfulness and justice. So whenever you are dealing with the ethics, you should have certain principles of the ethics that you should do for good. You should not harm anyone. You should respect the independence. You should deal with fairness, truthfulness, and justice. So approved ethics is gaining the ethical approval on a research before starting it. So if, for example, if you are doing any research on a particular person, then you should have an approval from that particular person whether they are okay to allow you to research on them or on their property or their assets. So the last one is basically the quantitative and qualitative methods we discussed earlier in the previous slides, their nature, their advantages and disadvantages. The next is the data analysis tools. Analysis of data is a process of inspecting, cleansing, transforming and modeling data with the goal of discovering useful information, suggestions, conclusions and supporting decisions. So whatever the data you have available, you have organized, it should have been maintained through certain tools. So there are lots of tools available in the market and they have their own advantages and disadvantages. So once you have a data, you should be able to use certain tools. So certain tools like 16 qualitative data analysis softwares are available and you can have a look on those and individually like NVivo, like Atlas. One is the SPSSF, which is mostly used by the researchers. They do use their tools, and this tool like SPSSF in the most of the researches, and there are many more. Really depends that how you are comfortable with these tools and accordingly. So the analysis of the tool is important. Whatever the data you have, you should consider about the ethics of the research. And then sampling techniques, how you will be getting the data and you will be applying certain techniques. So that's about the first. So is it clear, Abid? Any question about it?
Yeah.
You have any question?
No, not at the moment, sir.
Okay, so you are most welcome to ask any questions, you know, later on. So I end this session now and I would start the learning outcome too after a short break. Yeah?
All right, sir.